So it's a pleasure to have Luis Ibáñez to talk this morning about the Swampland constraints on scalars, light fermions, and gravitinos.
So let me first thank the organizers of this series of seminars in the Paris area. Of course, I would have loved to be there, to be in a terrace having drinking nice wine, but that's the way. It's not working then. Okay, we'll use this. Okay, so I think with this audience, I don't need to introduce what the Swampland is, but let me repeat again. The Swampland is the space of field theories which cannot be embedded into a consistent theory of quantum gravity. It is often formulated in terms of conjectures, which go, some of them are more rigorous than others, and some of them are more useful for phenomenology and cosmology than others. So probably the most rigorous ones, or with the ones with more support from string theory or other black hole considerations, for example, are the U1 weak gravity conjecture, completeness, the absence of global symmetries, etc. And the ones with the least support are those involving the behavior of potentials of scalars at the Sitter conjecture. But those are less rigorous but more useful. So of course we would like that eventually the rigor of the conjectures will increase, or else that some of them may fall down and never be proven at all. So let me just review for a start a few of these conjectures, only in general overview of some of them. Perhaps the oldest one, and the one with which is in some sense the crucial one, you know, this story is the absence of global symmetries, originally motivated by black hole physics, Noether theorems, and is clearly observed within the context of string theory. It has been generalized recently. This second one is, I find it quite surprising at first. I mean, that the existence of gauge bosons implies the existence of char particles. Probably, I don't know, probably this was Polchinski's idea, you know. But the fact that they are just Maxwell theory with Einstein's Lagrangian are inconsistent by themselves is surprising at first. Again, could be motivated from black hole physics. And generalized to the completeness conjecture, which was put forward by Polchinski, that in fact particles of all possible charges might exist. Although, of course, they don't need to be necessarily in the light spectrum. And finally, in this first series, the absence of free parameters in the theory is also a crucial ingredient, which is certainly is a fact in string theory. But perhaps the one which has been most widely studied, and there are more tests, is the weak gravity conjecture. The simplest version of a single U1 states that in any ultraviolet complete U1 gauge theory, there must exist at least one char particle with mass m, such that its mass is bounded by the char times the Planck scale. Again, this was originally motivated by black hole physics, yes, and the assumption, which can be debated, that extremal black holes must decay if you pose that condition. Just conservation of charge and kinematics tells you that there must be some particle with mass lighter than the Planck scale times the charge. And this, in fact, may be formulated alternatively, and that's precisely the origin of gravity as the weakest form, which is saying if you have a couple of particles with same mass and charge, Coulomb repulsion must win over the Newton attraction. You just impose that in the potentials, you get the same condition. And that's why this is called the weak gravity conjecture. There is the magnetic version of the same story applied to the dual U1 coupled to monopole, supposed to have mass smaller than the G magnetic times MP, which is 1/G MP. And for you have magnetic monopoles of some cutoff scale over G squared, that tells you that the cutoff is bounded above by G electric times MP, which means that if you look at it, if there is a small gauge coupling, the cutoff is low, so there must be new thresholds or must appear below the Planck scale. In string theory, you can observe this phenomenon. And the thresholds typically are Kaluza-Klein or string thresholds which appear. The most obvious example is the thing that mentioned on the erotic, whose string scale is G times MP. So when G goes down, you get the string cutoff scale low. But this fact that the limit G squared going to zero seems to be an example of a more general phenomenon, and was pointed out by Guri and Buffer in 2006, this so-called distance Swampland conjecture, that you have a theory with a modular space of scalars. As we move in modular space in the geodesic distance delta phi, a tower of states becomes exponentially massless. So you go from P to Q, distance delta phi, there is a tower of states here whose exponentially small masses control in this way, with the lambda parameter being of order one. And this phenomenon has been checked and observed in many string theory examples. And here there are some references, but there are many more. And then come conjectures involving scalar field potentials, and there are two broad classes, those referring to anti-de Sitter vacua and those referring to de Sitter vacua. Anti-de Sitter, you have the non-SUSY AdS conjecture and the AdS distance Swampland conjecture, which I will describe in a minute. And then the de Sitter conjecture is the Trans-Planckian SUSY conjecture, which are somewhat related. And I will make use of these two often in what follows. So let me remind you what these are. The non-SUSY AdS conjecture states that there cannot be stable non-SUSY AdS vacuum in quantum gravity. And so if you find one in your theory, this is something which we will use later, then it is inconsistent with quantum gravity. That's the statement. And it's true within known, or there are arguments to justify that this is true from the physics of flux string vacua. No obvious counterexample has been found, but this is certainly not at the level of the weak gravity conjecture for a U1. But I mean, there is solid evidence. And then there is the AdS distance conjecture, which in a few words states that one cannot go smoothly from AdS to Minkowski. So if you consider a family, you have a family of AdS vacua such that the cosmological constant goes to zero. You may have a family, for example, you have a vacua with fluxes, which you can vary, and then you get the family of models in which that happens. Then, so what happens is that when you approach Minkowski, the statement is that there is again a tower of states with this mass scaling like the cosmological constant to some positive power alpha. So that's the sort of weak version of the AdS distance conjecture. The strong version states that in fact alpha is equal to 1/2 in the supersymmetric case, so that there is no decoupling of on the AdS scale from the Kaluza-Klein scale, from the tower scale in some way. Mm-hmm. And in fact, that alpha should be smaller than 1/2 in AdS, general AdS vacua, and positive in general DS vacua. There is the strong version. But in fact, there are some, there's a possible class of counterexamples to the strong version. I mean, there are examples, explicit examples with alpha, this particular number, by the way. So, but the case of the weak one, which is just this statement that you get a tower going down with some positive alpha power here, has been tested in any number of vacua. Finally, and here is the I will finish the list of conjectures. This is the Sitter Swampland conjecture, perhaps the most predictive one and the most the one with less evidence, I would say, which states that any scalar potential Vf, Vphi in the theory of quantum gravity must verify that the gradient over V to be a positive number with C of order one. Or else, if that's not true, it must be that the lowest eigenvalue of the Hessian over B is more than minus some number of order one. This, if you look at this, it forbids minima, this for the sitter, the statement is for the sitter in principle. You have obviously minima, you have here zero would be implied, and in fact, extrema would be in violation of this bound, unless the what happens. I mean, if you may have maxima if it's, for example, not minimal, but maxima if it's sufficiently unstable. That this is the so-called, this is the refined version of the De Sitter conjecture. And also in the same paper it was proposed that in fact, this applies also to, I mean, if this for ADS would not give you any constraint because this is, it's true that a positive number is always bigger than a negative number, but this, and the authors also propose that it's true if you put here an absolute value. Mm-hmm. So gives us also some constraint for ADS. And finally, there's the transplant cancer associated conjecture, which I'm not going to review here. It's in somewhat related to the De Sitter one. It allows for a very unstable De Sitter minima. Okay, so in here I'm going to cover three topics related to these conjectures. First, I'm going to talk about the scalar weak gravity conjecture, trying to obtain a weak gravity conjecture statement for scalars in terms of pair production. Secondly, I will talk about the distance conjecture for the gravitino mass. Finally, a conjecture on the presence of light fermions and how it could be related to neutrinos. So let me go to the first. I'm going to use essentially the mostly this. What I'm going to say, we have connections with some of these distance and conjectures and the ADS non-Susi conjecture, mostly. So we mentioned the two formulations of the weak gravity conjecture. The first one was based on the stability of extremal black holes, and the second one was gravity as the weakest force, that two equal particles, charged particles, Coulomb repulsion switch between. It has been shown that they are equivalent to a large extent. When you go to multiple charges, there are some subtleties in the presence of scalars, but I mean, has been proven by Heisenberg that to a big extent they are equivalent. So, but this second one is different in philosophy in the sense that it is transmitting you the idea that gravity must be the weakest force. So what we want to do now is to take this proposal in seriously and assume that the as a general principle that gravity is always the weakest force. Both formulations involve U and gauge symmetries, but what about a scalar interaction? What can we say about an interaction of a scalar, lambda phi to the fourth, or maybe they could be moduli that then got some small mass eventually by some effect, or you could have the coupling of heavy states, some heavy BPS states or something, which depend on some moduli, and there are some coupling here, so couplings of this form. Are there these kind of interactions constrained by weak gravity considerations? And that would be interesting because perhaps one can motivate the conjectures which involve potentials like the De Sitter conjecture. So what happens when the lambda goes to zero? There is some, has to be, this interaction has to be stronger than the corresponding gravitational interaction. Of course, you have sufficient supersymmetry, two or more, lambda is proportional to g squared. So essentially, whatever you get with the weak gravity conjecture, it will hold. But here we are talking in general, including n equals one and zero. So our proposal will be to impose the principle of gravity as the weakest force to also do purely scalar interactions as a Swampland constraint. In fact, it was Palti who first proposed that as a condition. He proposed that if we have a modulus phi coupled to gravity, there must be weak gravity conjecture massive states H with mass M such that the interaction of these two heavy states by exchange of the interaction through scalars, and it must be stronger than the interaction through gravitons. Which since this coupling here may be considered, it is the derivative of M, you get this expression from these considerations. For large phi, they are consistent with this exponential behavior. So he proposed that it would be a sort of justification or some contact with the Swampland distance conjecture, which I just mentioned. Here, notice, however, that both interactions are attractive. So it's not the same kind of story as the normal weak gravity conjecture involving U1s. However, this proposal does not contain the quartic type of interaction that I was talking you about. I mean, this kind of interaction involving purely scalars. So we propose the following. When we consider the normal U1 weak gravity conjecture, we are comparing Coulomb and Newton potential, which corresponds to photon or graviton exchange at zero momentum. But perhaps you can, and that's a way in which you can compare both interactions, electromagnetic and gravitational. But if you're a particle physicist, you know that most of the time that's not the way you measure couplings. Normally what you do is some scattering processes, no? So an alternative way to measure and compare electromagnetic and gravitational interactions could be pair production at rest, I mean, at threshold. Mm-hmm. So the story would be similar to the one previously. So, if you have photons and gravitons, there must be a charged particle phi such that its pair production rate from photons is stronger than its production rate from gravitons. That would be the idea. So to impose. So it's a bit more complicated than the other simple Coulomb Newton potential, because you have to compute this diagram, this set of diagrams at threshold, which is trivial to compute this rate. And also this one from the production from gravitons of a pair of charged particles, which is non-trivial, particularly these vertices here and here are sort of a mess, but fortunately, you can extract the amplitude for that from results for the Compton scattering of gravitons on a charged particle, which was done by Holstein and doing using crossing. Okay, well, I save you the details, but imposing that the threshold, these two rates, this is stronger, this is bigger than the production from gravitons, you obtain this constraint. And the gauge coupling versus the masses. But it's the same constraint that you obtain from the Coulomb and the Newton potential. This may be generalized also to multiple U1s, which is a nice check that you can obtain useful constraints for pair production instead of potentials. So, but of course, the original idea for doing this exercise is not finding a third way to propose the weak gravity conjecture, but trying to obtain something similar for scalars. So we can repeat the story and consider massless scalars, moduli coupled to gravity, and complex one I'm going to consider in here. And the same story, you assume that there must be particles H and its pair production rate from scalars is larger than its product strain from gravitons. So then you compute these diagrams, and those were already computed in the previous transparency. And here you obtain this. This is from here, from this constraint, you obtain this constraint. These vertices are proportional to first derivatives with respect to t. Here there is a quadratic interaction which gives you a double derivative. That's a minor relative sign, and this is the condition you get, which is generalized for n complex moduli in this way. And this expression has interesting properties. It has contained built-in a certain duality. In fact, this is whole expression may be written in very in this very compact form, where f is just the log of m squared, if you wish. And you can see immediately that there is an invariance under f going to minus f, which means m squared going to 1 over m squared. And you have this because you have rates in here, because you are comparing rates, not amplitude, but rates. And then and this is a built-in symmetry of m going to 1 over m squared, just like it's sort of prepared to admit that Kaluza-Klein and Windis are going to verify these constraints. Secondly, note that this is a Swampland constraint. When the Planck scale goes to infinity, the constraint disappears. There's no constraint here. Now, of course, it's interesting to see if this kind of expression is verified in a string setting. And indeed, consider the as an example, take two A Calabi-Yau compactifications and consider the scalar moduli. The idea should be that there must be some massive states which couple to this scalar moduli, and that the condition we derive should be verified. And in fact, in these compactifications, there are DP states which come from DP branch wrapping even cycles, D0, D2, D4, D6, with some general expression for their masses in terms of the scalar moduli, the triple intersection numbers, and the color potential of the color moduli. In a simple toroidal orbifold, this is the field dependent that would correspond to these BPS states. And you can check that they saturate R1. I mean, after checking this, it was realized that in fact, it is saturated because n equals two theories, like the ones appearing in this compactification, have a special color geometry, which imply a condition on the central charges of this form. If you look at it, it's essentially very, very similar to our constraints, except for absolute value. So a particle which verifies this n equals two condition is going to satisfy our condition. So in retrospective, it's not surprising, but we derive it from the scattering of charged particles, no BPS considerations there in our derivation. So it's interesting to give a graphical plot for this condition here. So you have the gradient square in the y-axis and the double derivative term in the x-axis. And then what this condition tells you is that there is a region in between these two lines in which gravity is stronger than the scalar interaction. This is because there is a cancellation between these two terms. And then this is violated. So this region should not be allowed in field space. And the away from this region, gravitation is smaller than, interaction is smaller than scalar interactions in the sense that this is fulfilled. Okay, and you can check that in this example, these BPS states are precisely in the, they should in the boundary of this region for this, not the two, the four and the six. So when NP goes to infinity, this region, forbidden region, disappears. So that is nice, I mean, but it gives us constraints on masses of weak gravity conjectures, heavy states of mass m, like for example these BPS states, but give us no information about the moduli scalar potential. So let us assume that the potential of the moduli depends on masses of the weak gravity conjecture states, which could be, for example, Kaluza-Klein states or whatever. Let us consider a class of potentials which behave like some power of a massive object which obeys the previous constraint. So for example, this happens in type 2A Calabi-Yau vacua, AdS vacua with fluxes you're in AdS, the near the minimum, the potential behaves like the mass of the Gravitino square, or which behaves like the mass of the Kaluza-Klein state square. So, or if this AdS distance conjecture is at work, it is also happening. Mm-hmm. Okay, just assume that this is the case. Then putting this into our previous bound, you obtain instead a bound on the potential, which is very similar, essentially to replace the mass by a potential. And you get this expression, which is quite similar to the Sitter conjecture, but now it's derived from some principle. And you know that see that at the minimum, and when this is zero, you get a constraint on the second derivative, which is precisely very analogous to the refined constraint you obtain in the refined De Sitter conjecture. Also, if this expression is true, the Sitter minima would not be possible, at least at large phi, if the potential, as I write here, goes to zero at large phi, because of the following fact. Again, we do a similar plot, but now it is potential, not masses. Here is the gradient square, the second derivative square. And assume we have a potential with a behavior like this, it goes to zero at large phi, and then assume we have the Sitter minimum. Then you necessarily have the Sitter maximum always. You cannot avoid that. You have a minimum in that large distance. You have a runaway behavior, then you must have a maximum. So in field space, you should be able to go from a minima continuously to a maximum. But that's not possible without violating the condition. I mean, you have to go to a region in which this vanishes. So so you would violate the bound. So in this sense, the Sitter vacua in potentials of this kind would be forbidden. Assume now a different story. Suppose that we have just a self-interacting real scalar, like an axiom, for example. And consider the elastic scattering at low momentum. And compare it with the graviton production of a pair of such scalars. The diagrams involved are these ones in here, and then the ones from gravity I already showed. And then this is the condition you get. You get triple derivatives here because the mass is the double derivative in here. So here the couplings are triple derivatives. Okay, so this is the kind of condition you get. It's interesting to test this condition is fulfilled by known potentials like an action potential. Action potentials, we know that they appear in string theory. Potentials similar to this. If you plug that in here, this expression, you can see that it is obeyed as long as the decay constant of the action is smaller than MP. Which is interesting because this is the kind of condition which has been obtained from other Swampland conjectures than the weak gravity conjecture supplied to actions has this condition. Or consider a quartic potential, yes, like this, with only quadratic and quartic term, then this is the condition you get, which tells you that lambda, the self-coupling cannot be zero. And in fact, at the point phi equals to zero, the condition is that the lambda must be larger than the mass square over the MP square, sort of what you would say. I mean, this is the strength of gravity, and this is the strength of the self-coupling. So it's sort of reasonable that you extend that constraint. Okay, let me just conclude then this part on the scalar weak gravity conjecture first. So imposing a pair production of massive particles from modular stronger than graviton, you get this kind of condition, which has a built-in duality. And that four potentials, which verify this behavior, give you constraints on the potentials. And also conditions like this. So, an open question is that this could be applied to physical objects like the Higgs potentials of the standard model. You cannot apply the quartic potential directly because here you have more ingredients. You have several Gauge bosons. You have to include the Gauge bosons in the conditions. And they would tell you, I mean, at least the philosophy of this, that this plot, which is just the Higgs quartic coupling extrapolated to large energies, which is observed seems to be vanishing at some intermediate scale, it could be forbidden for this kind of consideration, which is, as I said, is has something which has to be studied in some more detail. So let me go to the second topic, this Gravitino Distance Conjecture. Since I'm going to talk about the distance conjecture, let me recall briefly the other two distance conjecture. There is the Swampland distance conjecture, SDC, which I mentioned to you. This is the appearance of when you advance delta phi in modular space, you get the tower of massless states. And the AdS distance conjecture, which is when you have a family of potentials going to zero, then there is an infinite tower of massless states appearing. With some power here, alpha, which is bigger than zero. Which are, of course, they give interesting information and tests of some ideas, but do not give direct information on quantities of relevant and relevant interest. So that was one of the motivation to address the case of the gravitino, because the gravitino is not an abstract tower, but it's a physical object. So the conjecture will go as follows. So consider an n equals one theory, but although we believe that this goes beyond n equals one principle, any theory with a gravitino mass. Mm-hmm. But we have tested in string examples with n equals one. Okay, the story is that in the limit when the gravitino goes to zero, again, a tower of states becoming light appear according to this. So with the mass of the tower, the latest state of the tower of states scales like the gravitino mass to some power delta, which is non-vanishing. So, okay. So what means this kind of expression is if delta is non-vanishing is that the gravitino mass cannot be arbitrarily light compared to the ultraviolet cutoff. Of course, the obvious question is, well, but zero gravitino mass is a low. Of course, zero gravitino mass is a lot. It's a different story. What this is saying is that you cannot go continuously from a theory with a non-vanishing gravitino mass to one with zero, absolutely zero gravitino mass without avoiding the appearance of this tower. Notice that in the case of SUSY ADS, one recalls the ADS distance conjectures at the minima, V naught is minus three and three half square for those cases. So then our delta here is just twice the alpha of the ADS distance conjecture. But the idea is that this applies also to Minkowski and De Sitter. As I said, we will use type 2 N1 oriented for with flashes as a test ground. But it looks like if this is going to be more general than this selected class of theories. In fact, I mean, the fact that this was happening is, I think, many people, including some in the audience, because I think Costas, you are in this paper, I think, already pointed out that in a specific, it was an heterotic vacuum, and this happens. I mean, if you want to lower the gravitino mass, then you lower the whole set of string states. The interest of this conjecture it has the gravitino mass selects in some way a direction in which the moduli can go with a physical interest and may have phenomenological consequences, I will mention in a minute. So there are the question, important point is what is the value of delta? Because if delta is zero, very close to zero, there is actually a decoupling. But you can derive a lower bound on delta, for, at least for this class of models, any cosmological idea that way oriented falls. These kind of models have this color potential for the color and the complex structure. And for the color, it's related to the volume of the color Villao. For the complex structure, can be written by short like this. And the string scale is related to Planck scale by this. And more importantly for us, the Kaluza scale, scale, we are going to consider the define our Kaluza scale like MS over the sheath power of the volume of the color Villao, which is sort of the overall scale of the Kaluza Klein particles, okay? Which in terms of MS can be written in this way, in terms of the color potential. No, we want to impose, we are using supergravity formula, so we want to have the gravitational mass lighter than the Kaluza-Klein scale, lighter than the string scale, and we want to remain in the perturbative regime both in 10 and 4 dimensions. So if your gravitational mass is defined like this in field space, then then you can relate this using this formula with the Kaluza, overall Kaluza-Klein scale in this way. But these factors in here are all are positive, and we are considering large fields because we are using the supergravity approximation. So this is something going to be positive and potentially large. So this is larger than the MKK to the 6. So you get that there is a lower bound on delta, with the tower being the Kaluza-Klein states, which is 1/3. In fact, we will not find examples in which the lightest tower is 1/3, but higher, as I will say in a minute. So the point is that as M3 have, is not arbitrarily decoupled from ultraviolet phases, if you go to zero with the gravitational mass, then also the Kaluza-Klein scale goes to zero. So let me just flash a couple of transparencies about the specific models of this class to get a flavor on what deltas you may get. This is the case of isotropic oriented folds, toroidal oriented folds, Z2 times Z2, if you wish, in which you may put fluxes, symmetric fluxes, so that you can describe the system in terms of diagonal STU moduli, as I studied in these papers. And then the color potentials in the are this simple, and this is the more general superpotential in terms of Ramon, which are these four, Neves bars, which are these four, and these are geometric flashes, which are also Neves bars, and here in this kind of models. No, note that here we don't have really a modular space. We have a space of moduli, if you wish, because depending of the fluxes. You are fixing the fluxes in some of the models, so for example, in the AdS. But still, the moduli scale as you vary the fluxes. Huh? For example, a typical example is this the Wolf et al. And the Camara et al. Model, in which you only have F0, F4, Ramon fluxes and H3 fluxes. And this is the superpotential. Then there is this flux, which is F4, is unconstrained by Ramon tuple cancellations, and then the modular, these are the real part of the modular, is scaled with this flux. So they are, of course, they are jumping discrete jumps, but there is, in some sense, a space of modular for those. Now you can compute the gravitational mass. You will find in this, you can prove that in all these kind of oriented models, also in Calabria oriented models, the gravitational mass goes like the tadpole fluxes, which contribute to the tadpole divided by the complex structure to the three halves. And then in this example, that's the expression how it behaves, the Kaluza-Klein scale with respect to the complex structure. So immediately you obtain this relationship, and delta is equal to 7/9. So this, by the way, is the example which was a violation of the strong and AdS distance conjecture. Another example, Minkowski sample, which is a no-scale example with metric fluxes.
Sorry, Luis, may I ask something?
Yes.
I did not understand here because you just said that the moduli U was fixed by the potential and then you vary it in the argument just like if it was a moduli. So in which sense can you really say that you can here, vary?
In the sense that they are fixed by a modulus which is really unconstrained. So it can go...
So you vary discretely the flux so that sense. You can go from one model to the other progressively.
You can obtain an almost continuous family of models of values for the cosmological constant by varying this flux.
Okay, thank you.
You contain an almost continuous set of values for the moduli. Which is, as I say, this is not a moduli space. We prefer to call it the space of moduli.
Thank you.
And then in this Minkowski example, the flux is fixed some of them. Of the moduli, but not others. So it's the modular space is sort of combined of discrete and continuous. And then in this case, the values of S and U, they are different, sorry. Then there is different towers in the X and Y directions. And you can see that the latest tower of Kalousek-Klein has two-thirds, delta equals two-thirds. There is a subleading tower with delta equals one-third. And here is another example in which you find a range of values because there is a direction which is undetermined. There is only this constraint. This U is not fixed and there is only this constraint imposed by fluxes. So that what you find is a range of values for delta, not a specific value. More generally, one can consider the behavior of S and T, ops. S and T in terms of the complex structure, in terms of some power R and Q. There is a strong restriction on the possible values of delta because of you have to import that the gravitational mass is lighter than the Kalousek-Klein scale, which is lighter than the string scale. Also, there's regions in which you go away from the perturbative region. So you are really confined to this small region for the value of the exponents R and Q. So there only certain directions in which you remain in a perturbative regime, your effective field theory makes sense, and your gravitino mass is below the Kalousek-Klein scale. So you look at this region, you find that delta is confined to values in between two-thirds and one in this class of models. You don't reach one-third for the leading tower. There are sub-leading towers which can have delta equals one-third. There's not only a Kalousek-Klein particles which go massless. In this, the gravitino mass going to zero, but there are also string states, strings which become tensionless in that limit. When the gravitino mass goes to zero, tensionless strings appear. To start with, the fundamental string also goes to zero. But there are also emerging strings coming from D4 brains wrapping three cycles, and the Nevis bar 5 brains wrapping four cycles. And you can compute the deltas for this, and particularly these D4 brain wrapping three cycles are always there in the sense that independent of any direction of field space, these strings are going to be we have delta equals one-third, so when the gravitino mass goes to zero, these strings will also go to zero. But they are above all the time, the Kalousek-Klein scale, by the way. And also membranes become tensionless. So more details one could go give about these strings, but I will not do that. It's more, there is some something which shouldn't be here. So is the here I'm talking about the connection of this gravitino distance conjecture with the Swampland distance conjecture. So let us identify the tower of the tower of the gravitino mass. This is the mass of the tower, the lightest in the tower in terms of the gravitino mass to the delta, and put this parameterization for a general Swampland distance conjecture e to the minus alpha d. Mm-hmm. Which we called this D delta before. Okay, then there is a connection between the alpha of the gravitino conjecture and the delta, the delta of the gravitino conjecture and the alpha of the Swampland distance conjecture. For this class of models, distorted models, the gravitational mass always goes like 1/(u^3). So log goes like this. And then the distance, we know the metric for this complex structure field. So it goes like this with the log of u. And then comparing this, what you obtain is that this is the precise relationship between the delta of the gravitational mass and the alpha of the associated distance conjecture in the tower. And then imposing the first conditions we derive in between 1/3 and 1 for delta, you obtain the constraints for alpha, 1/√6 as a minimum value and 3/2 as a maximum value. This is interesting because this range precisely agrees with the kind of exponent it is found from totally different arguments, just exploring the different directions in modular space by these people in Calabia type 2 compactifications. This analysis applies to only to the toroidal models, but it may be extended to general type 2 Calabia oriented for the 2 moduli using the formalism of limiting Hoyle structures. And this is done in the paper, so I will not describe that. Let me finish talking about the gravitino with mentioning some phenomenological implications. If take the minimum value for delta that we have found in a specific example, which is 2/3. And that means that there is at most, you can separate the gravitino from the Kaluza-Kalan scale in this way at most. So if you want to identify the gravitino mass with the electroweak scale, that means the Kaluza-Kalan scale has to be below 10 to the 8 GeV. Or if you want to identify the gravitino mass with an intermediate scale, also the Kaluza-Kalan scale is below the usually assumed unification mass. So the big desert scenario would not be possible in here. And also the Hubble scale for inflation would be lower below this scale. So you would expect negligible tensor perturbations. There are some recent considerations about cosmology in the gravitinos in terms of the velocity, the speed of the gravitinos. And let me go to the final topic. AdS Swampland conjectures and light fermions. So here I'm going to take the following philosophies. It's unrelated to the previous two stories. Consider a d-dimensional theory. So of course, if you do a circular compactification, you space you expect that the d minus one should be also consistent. So if you find that you have a theory, a d minus one compactification is inconsistent, you would assume, you would conclude that the d-dimensional theory is also inconsistent. Now, this principle has been successfully used in many weak gravity conjecture tests, doing dimensional reduction and imposing that upon dimensional reduction, you should obtain something consistent. So we are going to use this, the constraints of AdS conjectures, these two conjectures, to obtain, impose into a D minus one theory to extract constraints on the parent D dimensional theory. Okay, so that's going to be the philosophy. Specifically, we also will take this assumption, which is strong, I must say. The parent theory, the D dimensions may be unstable. This is the sitter and take the sitter. And we will assume that the instability is not inherited by the D minus one theory. So if such instability exists and there is a bubble for this transition, its radius is larger than the AdS scale of D minus one theory. Okay, otherwise you will not get any constraint. So the setting is that we compute the D minus one scalar potential, the radian potential of this dimension, from the tree level in the Casimir energy. You have a tree contribution, which is just a dimensional reduction in something proportional to the original cosmological constant that you had, and then some power 1/r, and this is in the Einstein frame. And there's the one loop correction, which is the Casimir energy, which may be computed. It was computed by these people in a different context, based on previous computations of Apple, which set up very old computations in the 60s or 70s. And in this expression, this is a Bessel function. This small r is just to set the scale. So you can put it to 1 GeV if you wish all the time. And plus minus, you get plus for fermions with period boundary conditions and minus for scalars. NBNNF is the number of bosons and fermions. This is what you obtain. But let me give you some intuition about this expression. This is for any dimension. So in particular, the limit r going to zero and infinity. The limit as r goes to infinity is going to diverge because there is some power of r over here. And here is an expansion in r, as r is supposed to be a small parameter. And the coefficient of this is a well-known number, yes, a constant number, known. And each of the coefficients here is proportional to this quantity, minus one to k plus one, supertrace, where I define the supertrace in this way. So the normal supertrace is k equals to one, and k equals to zero is the difference of number of, between number of bosons or fermions, okay? Now, this potential will diverge because of this power of r. With the sign, depending the sign of the on this coefficient here. Okay. So the first one vanishing is going to be the leading term when r goes to zero. And when r goes to infinity, the term which is going to be dominant is the one coming from dimensional reduction of the dimensional cosmological constant. And then there is the contribution of the massless, only the massless fermions and bosons that you get, which contribute something which is more suppressed than this one here in general. And d, small d, by the way, is big D minus one. Okay. Now, more massive states, one can see that due to the properties of the Bessel function is exponentially suppressed, okay? So that's the behavior for infinity. Now, the important point here, the intuition here is that if you have a theory of with gravity, the gravity which is massless always contribute to this. So this term is going to be you necessarily in any theory of gravity. If you only have gravitons, it will be negative. If in addition you have photons, it will be more negative. But if that's it, that's this term here is going to be negative. Of course, this one, it may be more important, but for example, in Minkowski, this vanishes. So let me consider the three cases. In Minkowski, the sitter and anti-de sitter. Now, these are qualitative structure of the potential. So given this form of the limits for small r and large r, in all what I'm going to say, I'm going to assume that the first non-vanishing superstring of this form is positive to obtain a condition. So obtain a condition only if this is true. This is true, the potential in this region is like this, but then the behavior for r, large r, in the case of Minkowski, depends on whether you have a surplus of fermion or not. If you have a surplus of fermions, you may obtain this situation and not, you are not necessarily in trouble. But if you do not have, if you have mostly bosons on the graviton, photons or whatever, then you necessarily have AdS minima. So, and then if you assume that there is no AdS stable minima, non-SUSY AdS stable minima, then this would violate the non-SUSY conjecture. So that's the general philosophy. So one concludes that in a d-dimensional Minkowski theory, such that this is true for the first non-vanishing trace, super trace, this is consistent with quantum gravity, unless there is a surplus of massless fermions which can mend the behavior for large r. An analogous condition is obtained in the sitter, but you can easily see that there is a little difference in here because you start from positive value here. And now you can avoid that AdS minima form. If it's enough, you don't need to require that the fermions are strictly massless, but only in you just using the potential, you can see it's enough if there is a surplus of fermions with masses smaller than the scale of the cosmological constant in D dimensions. So you obtain a constraint for that class of theories, depending on the sign of the supertrace. And in the case of the AdS, you can never avoid the presence of AdS minimum. It doesn't matter because you start from a negative value. So there is no way to, you could avoid the appearance of an AdS minimum. So cannot be cured by light fermions, like the previous case. So in a d-dimensional theory with this bigger than zero, it would be inconsistent with quantum gravity. If this is a negative, simply we don't get the condition. But this, note that this super trace for k equals zero, and imagine that the first non-vanishing one is for k equals zero. This is just the difference of between the number of bosons and fermions, for example, in the standard model. And it is positive. In the standard model, this quantity is positive. So you get a condition. So that's the, or you have a SUSY theory and which has the same number of bosons and fermions, and that is zero, but the first superstrate is, if it's positive, again, you get conditions. So one can encapsulate these findings in terms of a light fermion Swampland conjecture, which is says that in a SUSY broken theory with positive cosmological constant or non-negative cosmological constant, and fermion vanishing supertrace, and this happens, as I said, in many theories, it must be that there must exist a surplus of massless fermions with masses lighter than the cosmological constant scale. So this is the conjecture. And of course, it would be interesting to look for tests in string theory. Something which is, comes close to be a test is the 10-dimensional non-SUSY SO16 cross-SO16 heterotic, which is tachyon-free. It was computed by Dins et al. And recently by Kribiuri et al. That the supertrace, this quantity here, in fact, vanishes up to the k equals 4, for, so m8 in here, and it's positive. So if this was true, it would imply that there must be a surplus of massless fermions. You go to the theory, look at the, and there is indeed, one can say that there is a surplus of, in particular, 2,112 fermions. I say that it comes close to be a test because this modeling has is not really any of the kind of bucket I was describing because it is a runaway potential at one loop, not a minimum. So, but it's still, it's suggestive. So it would be interesting to test in other string theory models. Do I have 5 more minutes
Yeah, 10? Yes, please go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, now I'm going to apply this story to neutrinos and possibly the electrowheel hierarchy. So the point is that the, you take the standard model in compactify in a circle, you may obtain anti-de-Sitter vacuum. That's something which is generic. And the Kaluza-Klein replica are of order of the neutrino mass in that model. Now, if you get this, the fact that there was this AdS minima when you compactify in a circle, the standard model was realized by these people for different reasons. Now, if you impose that the non-SUSY AdS stable vacua, so that those AdS vacua are not stable, and also you can use the AdS distance conjecture, it turns out you obtain constraints on the neutrino masses. This, in fact, was already done in some papers 3 years ago. But let me remind you, and then what is new is that it, the same results can be confirmed independently using the AdS distance conjecture and also in quintessence models. So how this works for this physical example. So we are studying the region of scales in the deep infrared region of the standard model, in which you only have photons, gravitons, and gravitons, and neutrinos. And then the potential for the radion is the first term, which is inherited from the four dimensions, is proportional to cosmological constant. There is the contribution of photons and gravitons, which is negative. This is the story I was telling you about the negative contribution of gravitons and photons. And there is the contribution from massive states, which I'm going to concentrate only in neutrinos, because the particles which are heavier, their effect and the potential is exponentially suppressed. So really in the region below the electron mass, this is essentially the potential. Now, okay, this is again the Bessel function. Now, the story is that the potential from the cosmological constant goes like this, from the cosmological constant by the Casimir energy of photon and graviton goes like this in red. And so this goes in red, but now you have the neutrinos. If the neutrino is Majorana, the lightest neutrino is Majorana. It has only 2 degrees of freedom and it is dominated. There are more bosonic degrees of freedom and for R going to infinity. So your potential goes negative. But then come the rest of the neutrinos, eventually, altogether there will be 6 degrees of freedom, will win over the 4 degrees of freedom of photon and graviton, and you get necessarily an AdS minimum. So if it's true that there cannot be a stable AdS minima, that would be rule out this the case of Majorana neutrinos. We are assuming, of course, that this potential is stable. From the point of view of bubbles of nothing, this is stable because it's the neutrinos are assumed to have periodic boundary conditions. However, in the Dirac case, the lightest neutrino will have 4 degrees of freedom sufficient to compensate for the photon and graviton. And so not necessarily you get a minimum. You will get it depending on the value of the neutrino mass. So the lightest, what you find is that your lightest neutrino is lighter than 7.7 micro electron volts, just 10 to minus 3 electron volts, then it is okay. And no AdS minima form. That is, depends slightly on whether you are using normal hierarchy or inverse hierarchy of fermions. So so it's nice because it relates to fundamental case of physics, which is and in some ways predicting predicting that the cosmological constant cannot be absolutely zero, because if the neutrinos, the lighter neutrino has a mass, has to be its value has to be larger than the mass of the neutrino to the fourth. But also it may give light on the issue of the electron hierarchy problem in the following sense. The mass of the neutrino in this case, in the case of Dirac, but it can also be generalized to the case of the Majorana if there is an additional bile fermion around. But okay, let's consider the case of Dirac. It is just given by the expression with the very small u kappa in here. But then the bevel of the Higgs is bounded above by the cosmological constant divided by the u kappa coupling. So it cannot be arbitrarily large. So for fixed u kappa coupling, the Higgs bevel cannot be large. So the electron with scale is tied up to is related to the cosmological constant. Okay. Now, as I said, the caveat in here that this non-SUSY AdS vacuum that is formed are absolutely stable. And that assumes also that in the ultraviolet scale, I don't know, above the even electron wave scale, there is some minimum which arises and then makes the whole thing unstable. So turns out that the AdS in a different conjecture, the AdS distance conjecture gives independent support for the same idea in the following sense. Assume, here's again, there is an assumption, that there is a family of standard model for the vacuum in which the neutrinos masses scan. So you have the vacuum is such that the mass of the neutrinos, you have solutions in which the neutrino mass scale, this is the physically observed or existing mass. This lambda is a parameter in which goes from zero to some scale lambda star, which is bigger than one, so that the physical observed neutrino mass is in the range. Okay, so we are assuming that for the potential I wrote to a scan, to give me a family of theories in which the potential goes through zero, the only parameters you have for scanning is to vary the masses. So that's what we do here. And then if you do that with the Majorana neutrinos and you vary the values of the, you consider the varying the neutrino masses from zero to some value larger than one or larger, for lambda equals to zero with the 6 neutrinos would be light, so that they would not dominate and they would have to run away. But as lambda decreases, eventually a minimum will form necessarily. And so you will go you will go from AdS going back to Minkowski continuously, and there is no possible origin that one could see that there is for a tower of massless particles appearing here at a finite value. There's no, I mean, no Kaluza-Klein scalar tower going down at this particular value of R. Nothing is happening there. So it would be a violation of this AdS distance conjecture. On the other hand, in the case of the Dirac, happens something similar to what happened before. As you vary this, as you scan your neutrino masses, your potential scan also possible values. But if you set some value for the neutrino mass smaller than certain value, you will never reach and obtain an anti de Sitter vacuum. So you obtain then that one recovers the same conditions essentially numerically very similar to those from non-SUSY AdS conjecture. But the difference now is that there are no assumptions concerning ultraviolet disk, only needs information, local information about the neutrino. So let me finish here that this is, when you talk about this with Kum Rumbaf, I tell you, but what about quintessence? Because having a de Sitter minima is not something he would like. Mm-hmm. So perhaps the Sitter vacuum may be forbidden. So, and that what we have is some sort of quintessence model. Mm-hmm. So do we get the similar neutrino masses bounds? The answer is that with the AdS conjecture, no, because we don't get really, we have a potential which is combined of radiant and quintessence fields, and there is always runaway directions, and there is no AdS minima which form. However, then if you look, go back to the refined de Sitter conjecture, which I showed you at the beginning of this talk, in which you have this absolute value here, turns out that there are constraints in this case, total different origin. So I am assuming this is a toy quintessence model with just the typical exponential behavior of these type of models with some power alpha here. And then the potential would be in three dimensions would be this piece. There is a field dependence from the quintessence field and an R from the radion, and then you have the contribution from photon and graviton, and then the one from the neutrinos that I showed you, and then the contribution from the Casimir energy from the quintessence, and then assuming I save you the details, you compute this. This thing should be obeyed for. This is C, remember this is this quantity in here. It should be bigger than and something of order one. But you should see that it is violated by this in the case. I mean, if the neutrino is too heavy, say heavier than 10 MeV or 8 MeV, you can go down and violate this bound. And it is not the other condition, which is that this refinement doesn't save you, because this is a quantity we should be around this line in here. It is always above for the red line, for the green line, etc. So you get a bound also on the neutrino mass in this case. The origin is different because it's just a condition on the speed of variation of your potentials. You obtain anyway numerically something which is not very distant, which what you obtain in the case of a normal vacuum. And then, interestingly, the Majorana case is still forbidden. So this is an application of the previous. I'm not going to give you a long series of conclusions, but just the quantum gravity constraints effective field theories may affect hopefully standard model physics and cosmology in ways not previously foreseen. That. And we have to advance in two directions to understand better the origin and structure of the Swampland ideas, put the ones which deserve it, of course, in more solid grounds, testing them with string theory or other ideas, and then apply them to address pending issues in the beyond the standard model physics and cosmology. So thank you.
Thank you, Luis. So maybe we can unmute ourselves to thank Luis. It's time for a question.
Hi. What do you think is the best way to try to understand whether the AdS non-SUSY conjecture is actually true?
AdS AdS distance conjecture.
The non-SUSY conjecture.
Ah, the non-SUSY conjecture. Oof. I don't know. I mean, it's sort of, there are these argumentations in the original paper of in the case of fluxes, the situation is unstable, typically for flux vacua. But I don't know how to make further progress except for finding no contradiction within string theory. Also, it's difficult because it's not only perturbative, but most of the, I mean, you can find non-SUSY ADS perturbatively stable vacua. There are plenty of them in Orient Default models. But the point is you have to do in compute that there's no possible non-perturbative decay, that the bubble dynamics doesn't work out, and which is, it has been worked out in some cases, but it's not simple in general. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know.
Thanks. I also wanted to ask, in the earlier part of the talk where you discussed these constraints on the scalar lambda phi to the fourth couplings, what kind of assumptions on the gravity theory were being made? Does it have to have an Einstein type limit, et cetera?
I was using I was in Minkowski, and right. I was using Einstein gravity in four dimensions.
Okay. Thanks.
Yes, Kostas?
Yes, Luis. Do you have also a Gavitino conjecture alongside the Gravitino conjecture?
That would be a conjecture of the scale of supersymmetry breaking. Well, to the extent that the Gavitino mass is related to the Gravitino mass, something similar should apply. But I think the Gravitino is special, in this sense, because it has a close expression in terms of the supergravity theory. The Gavitino mass is more model dependent. It's I find it hard to do a similar conjecture for the Gavitino, but it makes sense to explore it. I think. Because the Gavitino mass could be decoupled somehow from the Gravitino mass, so it's not obvious.
Right. I mean, do you expect any particular ordering of the limits where they go to zero? No.
I don't have any special expectation. That's very model dependent, I would say.
Thanks.
Do we have other questions?
I'm sorry, may I ask a question?
Sure.
Yeah.
Good morning. In the first part of your talk, you discussed about this reformulation of the gravity conjecture with the pair production from both scalars or U1 gauge bosons.
Mm-hmm.
You discussed also the case that Malti in its paper of 2017 discussed. And so I was wondering, how would you apply your pair production method to the case where you have both the gauge bosons and the scalars?
Mm-hmm. It's true that would be the next step. The point with that is that you have to, I mean, we were lucky that we could extract for the pair production of particles from gravitons. There were computation in the literature of the contour scattering. However, for doing what you are telling me, there are other diagrams to be involved in the computation, which have not been computed, and they are not easy. But certainly that would be the next step. So yes. I don't know, at the moment we'll have to compute the new diagrams, which we haven't computed yet, and they are not easy to, that can be addressed.
thank you.
Do we have other questions? I may ask one related to your proposal on the non-SUSY ADS after dimensional reduction on the circle.
Yeah.
So when you compute the potential by summing the tree level and the volume contribution, I feel that the one loop is not finite usually in the theory, and you use analytic continuation and Poisson summation of the sum over Kaluza-Klein state to actually get a finite answer. So it's true that in string theory, usually applying this method is something that you can argue to be correct by relating to the modular integral of the string state, etc. But if you are in the standard model or completely non-supersymmetric theory, which has no straightforward string theory realization, I don't see how you can avoid the possibility that the cosmological constant would get renormalized in the appropriate formulation. So can you comment on this? Or?
You assume that yes, you renormalize the cosmological constant to the observed value, yes. But otherwise, apart from that, the rest is finite.
What I mean is that for me, it's not obvious that a three-dimensional renormalized value of the cosmological constant is the same as in 4D, that you would not get a contribution from the one loop. Contribution on the circle.
I don't see that. You still get this this potential. I'm telling you. After you have renormalized the cosmological constant. This is a final result. I mean, it's. You can find in this in the first computation of Arkani Hamed et al. And also a similar computation by Weiss, etc. Has been used abundantly in the literature on extra dimension models, in fact.
Yeah, the final formula is finite, but to get there, you use a formal manipulation.
Isn't it like the Casimir calculation? So indeed, you know, there's some infinite piece, but it's not radius dependent. So you renormalize it in four dimensions, as Louis says.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So you say that the renormalization would be the same as in the without the circle, it would not depend on the radius, so it should
right.
not. Be
right. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Is there any other question? If not, let's thank Luis again.
Thanks to you for your nice invitation.
Thank you.
See you sometime in